Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Well, I'm thankful to be here this morning to preach the Word of God again. Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah.
I'm thankful for the beautiful singing, the praise and worship. I'm thankful that He is Emmanuel, God with us.
Amen.
I thought about Moses when he said, "Lord, if you don't go with us, carry us not up yonder."
Amen.
I ain't going up yonder if you're not going with us.
Right.
Amen. I might have prayed something like that and said, "Lord, I ain't going down yonder. I ain't going down yonder to the bayou if you ain't going with me."
Amen.
I'm thankful that He is with us. Amen. And He's in our midst today to touch us and to do mighty, mighty things. Amen. The book of Acts many times has been called the Acts of the Apostles, but it's really the Acts of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
He's still doing mighty acts today through people who will believe upon Him and trust in Him and get in God's way and continue steadfast in it. If you have your Bibles, please turn with me to Romans chapter 1. Now, I encourage you to check out Crossline Radio and Television. Go to crosslinetv.com. You can hear the message of the cross being preached every day, all day. And I know that it'll be a blessing to you. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
God. All right. Romans chapter 1. And something I believe the Lord has laid upon my heart is up last night and this morning seeking Him about what I would say. Passage of Scripture is very important to me. Romans chapter 1, and we'll begin reading in verse 14. It says, "I am debtor both to the Greeks and to the barbarians, both to the wise and to the unwise. So as much as in me is, I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are at Rome also. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. For it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek." And the title of the message I want to preach this morning is "I Am Debtor." I am debtor. Let's pray. Father, I thank You for Your Word, and I thank You, Lord, for every opportunity to preach Your Word. Thank You, Lord, for the people who came out to hear it this morning. Lord, I pray for Your anointing, Lord, that You'd anoint my mouth and my lips to speak the Word of God, Lord. And Lord, let Your will be done. Your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. Lord, let the will of God be done in this sanctuary and in our hearts this morning. Lord, I pray that You would push aside, Lord, our own agendas, our own thoughts, our own desires, Lord, that we would lay that upon the altar this morning, and Your will, Your desire could be planted deep within our hearts, Lord, and You would give us a burden for those on the outside of this place that perished this morning. While we're in here worshiping the Lord God, there's people, Lord, that are perishing, and Lord, we pray that You would equip us this morning so that we can go out and preach this gospel to those that we come in contact with. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. And amen. I am debtor. The word debtor in this New Testament in verse 14, it's the same word as sinner. One who owes a debt. It's translated sinner in many places in the New Testament. And the Apostle Paul comes and says, "I am debtor." Not that I am a debtor, but as if that was his name. That's his title. That's what he's called. I am debtor. Well, what debt does the Apostle Paul owe? Well, we know that in Acts chapter 9, he met Jesus on the road to Damascus. He's a proud, jealous, zealous Jew who persecutes the church. And if he would have died in that condition, he would have perished. But he met the Lord Jesus Christ. And when you meet Jesus, we know that the sin has been washed away. A new creature is birthed, and God has forgiven us of our sins, past, present, and future. And there's not a Christian, someone who's been born again today, who owes God for his sin.
That's right.
We're not a debtor. Those that are lost are debtors, but the problem with that is you can't pay it back. You can't pay the debt. The Bible says in 1 Peter 1:18 that we're not redeemed by corruptible things such as silver and gold, but by the precious blood of the Lamb, without spot, without blemish. That's the blood of Jesus was the price paid for our sin debt on the cross of Calvary. So what's the Apostle Paul talking about? I'm a debtor. I am debtor. He's talking about the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. He owes a debt to everyone that he comes in contact with. The Apostle Paul's a man on a mission. He's a man with a burning desire in his heart. That's his mindset. I'm not Paul. I am debtor. I owe something. And I was in a gravel pit in Crystal Springs, Mississippi. We got a little construction business, and I was on a tractor moving dirt one day, and I read the Bible a lot of times while I'm driving the tractor. I read the book of Romans multiple times, but one day I'm in the first chapter of Romans, and I look there at verse 14, and it was like, brother, I've never seen it before in my life. I am debtor. And the Spirit of God began to move. How many of you know you don't have to be in church for the Spirit of God? God began to move upon my heart, and I stopped that tractor. Brother Matt, I got behind the wheel. I got off, and I put my head down like this, and I prayed, and I said, Lord, forgive me. Lord, forgive me for misrepresenting you. Everywhere that I go, I am debtor to everyone that I see, to the people that are around me. I owe a debt. I believe that brother said that he had a song laid upon his heart. Everybody ought to know who Jesus is, and every man ought to tell somebody who Jesus is. I am debtor. I owe a debt.
Yes, in the name.
That's the heart of the Apostle Paul, and I cried there and I said, Lord, forgive me. How many people have I passed by that I got this pearl of great price? I've been equipped to preach the gospel, but instead I've been preoccupied with something else. I got my head in the clouds. I'm being self-conscious, self-absorbed in my own agendas, that the last thing we are sometimes is sensitive to the needs of others. The church has in its mind that if we'll just buy some clothes, if we'll be a part of the food pantry and give canned goods to the hungry and blankets for cold people and clothes for naked people, that we're meeting the needs of humanity. But humanity has a much greater need. It is the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that is the debt that we owe.
Yes.
I am debtor. You are debtor. The brother Swaggart says in his expositor study Bible, he says it's true of every believer. It's not isolated only to the Apostle Paul. If you want to look with me in Ephesians chapter 3. Philippians 4 and verse 11. It says that he gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors, and some teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, and for the edifying of the body of Christ. A lot of people think that all Christianity is we'll pray a prayer with a preacher down front one day, get baptized a couple weeks later, and we'll just find a good pew to be comfortable in, and all the work, it's laid upon the pastor's shoulder. He does evangelism. He preaches. He does all the work in our community. And sadly, that's what's going on in most churches around the country. All the weight of the church is usually laid on about three or four people.
That's right.
While the rest of the people, they want to be served, but they don't want to serve anybody else. The Bible says that God gave you that pastor. God gave you an apostle, a prophet, evangelist, a pastor, and teacher. This is what he's to do for the equipping of the saints, for the perfecting of the saints, which actually would have been better translated, the equipping of the saints. Perfected many times in the scripture, it means to be complete. It means to be made whole, but here it means to equip. It means that the pastor is to deposit in you, to equip you, to teach you to do what you've been created to do.
Amen.
You know what you've been created to do? You're the light of the world.
Yes.
You're the salt of the earth. And what you've been created to do is to go out and to win souls. The pastor, there's only so many people that the pastor can reach.
Come on, brother.
Brother Matt can reach the people here that come to the church and his congregation. He can reach his family. He can reach the people on his job. But there's some folks that you know that he doesn't know that he'll never see. He'll never meet. You know those folks need Jesus too.
Amen.
You know those folks, every man. The Bible says it's appointed unto man once to die. After this, comes the judgment. The people on your job, one day there's coming the judgment.
That's right, brother.
Well, they will stand before God Almighty, and they'll give an account for their life. And if they don't know Jesus, the account's not going to be very good.
Come on, brother.
They'll have no refuge, no place to hide. I am debtor. I owe a debt. The Apostle Paul said in 1 Corinthians 9:16, he says, "Woe is me if I preach not the gospel." He said, "Of necessity, it's been laid upon me. Woe is me if I preach not the gospel." This is not just a preacher thing. It's a Christian thing. That's what Christianity does. The Bible says they were first called Christians in Antioch. You know why they called them that? The disciples didn't show up and say, "We'd like to be called Christians now." But no, they saw the character and the nature of the Lord Jesus Christ being formed in a group of people long after Jesus had transcended back to the Father, because He was living through them, reaching through them. And that is what the church is to be today, the body of Christ.
Hallelujah.
For the work of the ministry. Ministry there, it means service. Jesus said, "I didn't come to be ministered unto, but rather to minister and to give my life for a ransom for many." He didn't come to be served. He left His throne in glory. Isaiah saw Him in Isaiah chapter 6. The Bible said He's high and lifted up, seated on His throne, and His train filled the whole temple. It means the coattail of His robe. It just wrapped around and filled that whole temple. There's six cherubims up there flying around crying, "Holy, holy, holy unto the other." He's been served. He's a prince in a palace, because that is where He belongs.
Hallelujah.
But when He came for service, He stripped that train off. He became humble. He became in the form of sinful flesh. He came down to this earth not to be served, but to serve us. And He served us on the cross with His shed blood. And He's made service. He's equipped us for the ministry. He's equipped us for service here. Hallelujah. On this earth. That is your heart. Yeah. Service. Jesus said, you know, everybody wants the pulpit. Everybody wants the spotlight and all of this. But Jesus said, whichever one of you will be greatest among you, let him be your minister.
Yes.
Let him be your server. That's what we've been called into. Not to make our name for ourselves, but to lift high and magnify the name of Jesus. And not just in a church service on Sunday, but everywhere we go, we've been equipped for the ministry. Everywhere we go, I am debtor. I owe a debt to that lost humanity out there. The Bible tells us in 2 Kings chapter 7, I won't turn there. Last night we were in 2 Kings chapter 4. And the Bible said that Elisha came to Gilgal. There was a famine in the land. There's nothing to eat. Well, he made some pottage there for the prophets to eat. But in chapter 7, that famine, it continues on. Didn't just quit when Elisha fed the prophets. But in chapter 7, the famine is still going on. And it got so bad that a woman came before the king. And she's upset. She's distressed. "What's wrong with you?" Well, she comes to report this other woman and said, "Yesterday, we made a deal. Me and this other woman made a deal that we would boil my child and eat him. And that's what we did. But the deal was, we're going to eat mine today, but tomorrow we're going to boil your child and eat him. And the problem is, she won't give me her child so I can boil him and eat him." That's how bad the famine is. That's how bad that depraved nature outside these walls is. Without God, there's absolutely nothing.
Amen.
That lost humanity will not do.
Amen.
To feed its own fleshly, selfish desires.
Amen.
Come on.
But the Bible says that the king, when he heard that, he rent his clothes. He tore his clothes off, threw dust and sackcloth in the air. And he's crying and repenting because he don't know what to do. But the Bible said that there was some lepers. They're sitting around. "We're going to die. Just assume we might as well sit here and die. We're going to die anyway." But the Bible said that they went down to the camp of the Assyrian army, the mighty army who's come to afflict the children of God in their time of famine and distress. But God performed a miracle while these lepers laborers who couldn't, you know, they couldn't fight their way out of a wet paper sack. They're not a seed in great army. They're not a force to be reckoned with. But as they're walking down the road, God made the Assyrians hear a great army marching to them. So they left their camp. They left all of their goods. They left everything. And these lepers stumble into the camp. There's all this food. There's everything. The famine's over now. And they're sitting in there, man, they're having a potluck, like a Sunday potluck, eating all that stuff. But the lepers, one looks to another one. He said, you know, it's not good for us to sit here and eat all this while our fellow man is back there starving in a famine. He said, if we just sit here and feed our belly, some mischief is going to come upon us. So they sent word back to the people, and the people who have been starving, they're in a family, they're eating one another's children out there. Now they come back in and there's food, bread upon the table. Those lepers represent you and I. We've stumbled up on a great salvation. Yes. It looks like we stumbled up on, but God has been trying desperately our whole lives to get us to the place where we would believe upon the Lord Jesus Christ. And God set us in a great room where there's bread on the table. There's bread in a time of famine. We found in this lost and dying world, we found an anchor that holds. We found a life support, a solid foundation. His name is Jesus. Yes. God says it's a sin for you to just keep that to yourself.
Come on, brother.
But to let that light shine, hallelujah, to the world. The Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 that the new creature has been given a ministry of reconciliation. You've been brought in. Are you a new creature? Could you lift your hand if you're a new creature? Well, you new creatures, God has given you. That means He has deposited within you something that you did not have. God placed within you a ministry of reconciliation. When you were lost, you didn't care one bit about your fellow man. If you're sitting here and raise your hand that you're a new creature and you still don't care about the millions that die and perish each year, you're probably not a new creature. But when you've been born again, God gave you a ministry of reconciliation, and you have a desire in your heart. Oh, it may have gone out, but it just needs to be rekindled this morning. You need what Jeremiah had, a fire shut up in your bones. The Word of God in your heart like a fire shut up in your bones. And it is my ministry that those that are on the outside who've been separated from God by their sin would know the message of Jesus Christ and Him crucified so that they can be reconciled unto Him. Bible said, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall see God. The peacemakers, that's not just those that try to just be nice to everybody.
Come on, brother.
Just try to settle arguments and quarrels. No, peacemakers. The Bible says in Colossians 1:20 that Jesus made peace. He fabricated peace. He constructed peace through the blood of His cross. The cross of Calvary is God's plan of peace. And the peacemakers that are going to see God are those who preach the gospel. God said you got pretty feet if you bring the gospel of peace. Hallelujah. That's what God wants us to bring upon our feet. Amen. I am debtor. I owe a debt. Bible tells us in Romans chapter 6 and verse 17, it says you were once a slave of sin.
Come on.
But you've obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine that was delivered to you, being then made free from sin. You became the servants of righteousness. The word servant or slave is an interesting word. And it means that you've been bound to another with ties so strong that only death can break them. You came into this world tied to Satan, tied to that old man Adam right there, and he's headed for destruction. He's headed for hell. But God allowed you to hear the gospel. You're just a leper sitting there fishing to die anyway, but God allowed a miracle to occur in your life, and you heard the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. You put your faith in that gospel and cry. God plunged you into the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. And when you died with Christ, your ties to Him, they were severed. Yeah. They were broken. And now a new tie has come as you've been baptized and immersed into the person, into the death of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.
And a servant a servant of righteousness. That's what you became. Means that your will has been swallowed up in the will of another.
Yes.
Your will has been engulfed in the will of another. The Apostle Paul would write and say, Paul, a bond slave, a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm not the prisoner of Nero. I'm not the prisoner of Rome. I'm in prison tonight because God wanted me to be in this prison so that I might preach the gospel. I am debtor. That's why I'm here. I'm here to pay my debt to a lost and a dying, a broken humanity. That's what I've been sent here for. My will has been swallowed up in the will of another. You know, there's a lot of Christians that claim Jesus is Savior, but they reject Him on the basis of Lord.
Come on.
Lord means ownership. Lord means that He owns you. The Bible says that you're not your own, but you've been bought with a price. And it wasn't a couple of pieces of silver and some gold. It was the blood of the sinless Lamb of God. And He didn't have to die for you, but out of His love and His heart of love, He gave His life for you.
Yes.
And He shed His blood to purchase you. Not just to give you a free pass to heaven.
Come on, brother.
Not just some fire insurance. But to give you a new life and give you something, put something inside of you that says, I have the answer to this world's problem. I might be a cowboy from North Mississippi, but I'm telling you, I've got the answer. I am not the answer, but I'm the answer in His name.
Hallelujah!
And woe is me, the apostle said, if I don't preach that gospel. That's what I'm here for. Amen. He said, both to the wise, to the Greek and to the barbarian. Greeks have all this knowledge. They think they're the intellectual center of the world, and they got a lot of money, and they like to sin. When you mix all that together, money and smart wisdom and sin, you got a big mess on your hands. But the Lord sent him to those Gentiles, and the gospel worked on those Gentiles. If you'd have asked some of us before we met the Lord, would we be sitting in church this morning, worshiping Jesus, lifting our hands and glorifying the Master with tears rolling down our face? I said, no, sir, not me. I'm not doing that, but God has a way of riding that proud and haughty heart down to the dirt until you get to the place where you realize that your whole life is a sham, your whole life is a mess.
Come on.
And that you need Jesus. That's what God did in Corinth. That's what He did here in Rome. But He says, I'm here for the wise and for the unwise. And the wise can mean skilled New Testament teachers. You know, I don't really change my message when I go from church to church. I just got one message. Whatever the Lord has laid upon my heart, I don't care if I'm preaching to a group of preachers or in a prison preaching to a bunch of people that I don't think are saved. I'm going to preach the same thing. Paul said that thing is the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. I owe a debt to the wise and to the unwise. Paul said in Philippians chapter 3 and verse 1, he said, to write the same things unto you, for me it's not grievous, it's not a burden to get up and preach the same thing every service. But he said, it's not grievous for me, but unto you it is safe.
Hallelujah.
It's safe. It's safe to be in a place. You may say, Brother Matt, you just say the same old thing every Sunday. It's all about Jesus, all about that blood. It's all about that cross. But for you, it's safe.
Yes.
It's a safe place to be where I can come in and I know that the man of God is going to open up the scriptures and point me to Jesus and His cross. And I know that He loves me enough to point out the failures and the problems in my life. But I know that God has equipped him to pour the meal back in that pot. He's equipped the man of God to teach me the word of God in light of Jesus and His cross so that the problem might be fixed. It's to the wise. Those that are skilled, those that are known. Brother Swaggart says that there is no graduating class in the message of the cross. If you think you already know anything, everything, you might want to find somewhere else to go. But if we could just be like the sons of the prophets that we read about last night, that just sit down at His feet and listen to His teaching. Just tell me about it one more time, about this great salvation that the Lord Jesus Christ has given me. It's to the wise. And He said it's also to the unwise. Unwise, it means unlearned and ignorant. It's really not an insult to be ignorant. Ignorant means that you just don't know.
Right.
for a lot of things we were ignorant about for a long time.
Amen.
Because we just didn't know. But thank God that he had another debtor.
Yes.
Oh, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That wouldn't give up. In spite of what other people said about him, in spite of what the media might have said about him, the man had a debt in his heart for a lost humanity, and he found the answer.
Amen.
He found the truth in the scriptures, and he came to pay that debt, to give it to the other people so that you and I might have and experience what he has. And now we're not unlearned and ignorant now, but now we've been equipped for the ministry. We've been equipped with the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And you know what you'll find? If you go out to preach this gospel in other places, you know, I enjoy very much preaching in a church where the people already know the message. We don't have to explain everything, but you know, pretty much anybody could preach in a church where the people want to hear.
Yes.
Amen.
There's nice music being played, and there's the Spirit of God is in the house, and it's not a hostile environment, it's a friendly environment. But you get outside these walls with people that are living in sin, people whose heart has been hardened and calloused by a hard life of sin. The Bible says that the god of this world, Satan, has blinded their eyes,
right,
because they cannot see.
Right.
You go out there and you'll find that it's hostile and that it's dark. But you know, just like when we went to that St. Patrick's Day parade, we walked through there, asked people, "Do you know Jesus?" Everyone, unless they're just a blatant atheist, "Yeah, I know Jesus. Yeah, I know. Are you saved?" "Yeah, I'm saved." "Well, how'd you get saved?" "Well, look at you like a deer in the headlights." "Well, I don't know." "Well, can I have a few minutes to tell you what it is that I believe?" And you begin to share the gospel with the people, and you can see it on their face that God is using you. God is, me and Brother Matt were talking about it before the service, a miraculous thing can occur. One time I was walking through a mall in Greenville, Mississippi, and I ended up in the shoe department. People sitting on those little benches trying on shoes. I was right there in the middle of the place. Everybody in shoe department, their eyes were on me, and I was preaching the gospel, and nobody opened their mouth until I was through with what I come to say. Amen. God can open a door like that. God can open the eyes and the hearts of the people. Most everywhere we go to preach, we get run off. But God gives us a window of opportunity. And those who have an ear to hear will hear that day if they allow their heart to be soft and pliable. But just like at the parade, you go to explain the gospel with people. And instead of getting angry, many of them said, "Thank you for that. Thank you for explaining. Thank you for sharing." You know why? Because they're ignorant.
That's they right. didn't know.
They don't know.
Amen.
They never heard the gospel truly explained. You know, I went to church all of my life, and I'm not mad at anybody, and I don't hate anybody there. But I didn't know anything about the new creature. I didn't know anything about grace. I couldn't have told you what grace was. If it was multiple choice, I still got it wrong. I don't know. I'm ignorant of it. And when you're ignorant of what the grace of God is, your life is going to show it, because you're going to live by laws that you've made up in your own mind. And the Bible says that the strength of sin is the law. You're going around trying to do right in your own strength with what you think is right, and your carnal mind is going to give strength and power to the sin nature, and you're going to see Adam and not Jesus Christ being formed within your life. But we have been equipped with this thing, and today I am debtor. You are debtor. You are debtor. And the Lord's going to hold you accountable for the light that he's given you. He wants you to share it with other people. He wants to equip you for the ministry. We don't just come to hear a nice sermon and take some notes. And, you know, I get a little frustrated. Sometimes people just come up and say, "You know, boy, that's a nice message that you preached. Just bless me so." No, I didn't come for that. I come to deliver what I feel is the Word of God for this hour. And what I want for you is to receive it and do something with it. Let the Word of God, just like good seed being sown into good ground, it's not going to say that's some good seed, but it's going to absorb that seed, and that seed is going to bring forth an abundance of fruit. And today you could get a revelation that God says through the Apostle Paul that you are dead, or you owe a debt to your fellow man to share and to explain the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ to him. And you can say, Lord, help me. Help me with what to say. I don't know how to do this. I don't feel comfortable doing this. And God will equip you for the ministry. I don't know what to say. I guarantee you that if you've been coming to this church for any length of time, listening to the message of the cross, you know more than you think you know. And many times when I talk to people, or even when I'm preaching, something will just come right out of my mouth, and I'll say later that I didn't even know I knew that. Didn't know where I even knew that. I don't know where it come from. It's God bringing it out of you. You've been equipped for the ministry, and the message of the cross is in you, and that's what the people need, and the Holy Ghost will see to it that it flows out of you, and the people receive. See what they need. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Wise and to the unwise. Verse 15. Verse 14, he says, I am debtor. Romans 1. Verse 15, he says, I'm ready. So as much as in me is, I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are at Rome also. Ready, it means that it's a burden that consumes the Apostle Paul's soul, a burden that drove his life, brother, a burden that consumed everything that he was. I'll do what it takes to follow the Lord and to preach the Word of God. I am ready. Speaks of being instant with everything that is in me. As much as in me is, I am ready with all that I have. I don't have another agenda. You know, the problem with us most of the time is we've got other agendas. I'm not telling you to neglect your family, your duties, or your obligations. But there's places in your life, things in your life that can go that you can live without to make room for the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ to go forth and for you to have time to present it to the people. Simon Peter said this in 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 15. He says, but sanctify the Lord in your hearts and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh you for a reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and with fear. He says, always be ready to give an answer, to give an account for the hope that is in you. You know, a lot of times people have a problem or something like that, we'll give them some little churchy answer.
Come on.
Like, Jesus loves you. Or we'll put you on the prayer list, or it's going to be all right, you'll get through this, or something like that. No, that's not what he's talking about. He's talking about being ready at any time to preach the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ to the person so that they can see that their every need, no matter what they have need of, if they're on alcohol or drugs, or their kids are on that, or their marriage is falling apart, there ain't but one answer to every problem, and that is Jesus Christ. And his cross. But if we're so preoccupied with our own agendas, the last thing we'll be, as I said earlier, is sensitive to that need.
That's me.
Holy Spirit, flow through me.
Yes.
Just like the man in Luke chapter 11, he's knocking at the door at his friend's house because another man has come and it's midnight. He don't have anything to feed him. And he says, give me 3 loaves. And the man says, no, go away. And he says, no, my friend has made a long journey and I don't have anything to feed him. And the man keeps knocking, he keeps seeking. And finally the man gives him what he needs because of his persistence, because of the lateness of the hour. That's a type of you and I seeking God for the Holy Spirit, for the double portion that we talked about last night. God, the hour is late. I don't have anything to feed these people. There ain't nothing in me that can meet that need, but I'm knocking on the door of heaven saying, Lord, would you equip me with something to feed these people with?
Yes.
Lord. In a time of famine, something to give them to.
Yes.
Something to give, hallelujah, unto them. He says, sanctify the Lord. That means to hallow or to revere, to set the Lord apart. In your heart, there should be a place in your heart for the Lord, a softness in your heart for the Lord that is devoted unto Him. where none other can go. And he says, and be ready always. Ready means to be prepared. It means to be adjusted. And it means to set in order. I believe it's talking about your priorities. Set your life in order. As I said earlier, there's a lot of places in our life where we can trim the fat. Cut away some things that are unnecessary and useless to the cause of Christ. Ask the Lord to show it to you and cut it away so that you can be ready when the opportunity comes. Or sometimes there's a divine appointment where God brings you to an intersection with another human being that's had a crisis in their life and their heart has been prepared. Their walls have been broken down. The soil has been plowed and prepared. And in that moment, you and I need to be equipped. Ready to give an answer. Things have been set in order. My life has been adjusted and I'm ready always. Always means instantly. Right now, brother, I'm ready as everything that's in me with as much as in me is. I'm ready to preach the gospel to you there at Rome. And he says, be ready to give an answer. The word answer means a reason or a defense. It means a plea. Why don't you try Jesus?
Praise God.
Why don't you try Him? Make a plea with the people. And He says to do this with meekness and fear. I'm ready. I think of it like an army, man. It's ready, aim, fire. We've taken aim. We've readied the weapon. We've taken aim and we're ready to fire. But you know, it's not that we just cut people down with the word.
Come on.
We're not trying to just chop people down. You know, after I first got saved, and I think Brother Matt has a similar testimony, I just fell in love with the word of God and I read it and the Lord allowed me to absorb it and to stick in my mind where I could just quote the scriptures and it would just flow right out of my mouth. But you know what it produced? It produced a self-righteousness in my life. And I believe that I began to lean upon what I knew rather than what Jesus has done for me. And the Lord allowed some things to come back on me to show me that I'm not as hot as I thought I was. I'm not as equipped as I thought I was. He says to give an answer with meekness.
Yes.
That's humility.
Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, hallelujah. I used to be in the same boat that you're in, man. But by the grace of God, He pulled me out of it and made a new creature out of me. And He wants you. And the Bible says to do it with fear. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, it says, knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. We know the terror of the Lord. The Bible says that it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. As I said earlier, every man is appointed once to die, and after this it's going to be the judgment, and at the great white throne of judgment every man will give an account for his life, but none will pass because it's too late.
That's right.
They've rejected the offer that God has laid upon the table for their salvation and for the deliverance. And God's going to show them every reason why He's going to cast them into hell. You see these courtrooms on TV, like court TV, where the defendant, he's spouting back off. He's talking back to the judge. It won't be like that. At God's great white throne of judgment, it'll be total silence. And the only voice that'll be speaking is the voice of God Almighty. And it will be a voice of judgment. Because His love and mercy has been passed by. And then the Bible says comes a lake that burns forever with fire and brimstone. Knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. With meekness and with fear we give an answer. Do you see how important it is? Not talking about it. You know, people get upset about the football team losing. You can't talk to them for a week. Upset about it. It's not something temporary. At this judgment, we won't be thinking about ball games.
That's right.
The cares of this life will be quickly fading away. God has a book, the Lamb's Book of Life, and the names right now that are going to be a part of God's eternal family are being recorded. But everyone whose name is not in the book will not be in glory. be in hell.
Come on, brother.
And it's not, you know, it'd be bad enough to go there for 3 years.
That's right.
30 years. 3,000 years. No, it's forever. No second chances.
That's right.
No more altar call. Paul says, I'm ready with everything that is within me. It's time that you and I would get a burden for the souls of men. You know, on my job, I meet a lot of people. I travel the state of Mississippi. I do construction work. And, you know, I found that the best thing for me to do, Brother Matt, is when I get there, I go ahead and I tell them who I am and what I am, what I believe, what I stand for. I'm a preacher of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. I love him. He found me in a bad place a few years ago, but he set my feet on solid ground, and I asked them, do you know Jesus? Are you saved? And I found that it's better. God, would you give me, would you grant me a Holy Ghost boldness so the moment that I step out of this truck that I might stand in the whole armor of God, that everything that is within me, Lord, I want to be ready to preach the gospel. And it's much easier to do it then than it is several weeks down the road.
Come on, brother.
They think you're just one of the guys.
Mm-hmm.
One of the girls that you just fit in with everybody. No, go ahead.
Come on.
Let the Lord speak through you. Let the Lord deposit within you a boldness and a burden to speak to the people. Who says this? I am ready. The Apostle Paul says it. And I started thinking, man, this is a seasoned veteran. He's been in it a long time. He knows more than all of us been put together. He's been saved longer than most of us have. And now he says, I'm ready.
Mm.
You know what it is? It's a lot of preparation.
Yeah.
Has gone into the man of God. Years of trials, tests, years of failure, but now he's been brought to the place where he's ready. And I'm not telling you to put ministry on the back burner, but I'm telling you to press in and seek the Lord and be acquainted with him. Remember those seven sons of Sceva? They come up to cast the devil out of a guy. And he says, in the name of Jesus, come out. And the demon speaks up, said, we know Jesus. And we know Paul, but who are you? And the demon whipped them naked and run them out of town because they didn't know Jesus.
Come on.
Are you ready? You know, I know some preachers. I'm not picking on anybody, but it's just like they get in the pulpit and kind of like Superman.
Yeah.
You know, Superman is just an average guy when he's got his regular clothes on.
Mm-hmm.
But then when it comes time to do the test, he puts that cape on. Now he's got supernatural strength. Now he's different than everybody else. He's stronger than everybody else. He's just a notch better than... There's some preachers like that get in the pulpit and use it just like a cake to say things and act in a way that they wouldn't normally act. I'll tell you something. I ain't no different up here than I am out there. This pulpit doesn't mean anything. We must be prepared. We must be ready. This pulpit doesn't make you a man of God.
That's right.
Amen.
A sermon doesn't make you a man of God. Your life should be as much consumed by the Lord Jesus Christ in here as it is than it is out there. Otherwise, we're just hypocrites.
Amen.
A hypocrite means ones who pretends.
That's right.
Playing Superman on Sunday, putting the cape on and pretending.
Mm.
No, 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 that's not it at all. Paul says, I'm ready.
Yeah.
With everything that is within me, this one thing I do. I forget those things that are behind me and I press on to the mark of the high calling of God that is in Christ Jesus. One scripture that I wanted to bring out here about being ready is in 1 Timothy chapter 3. The Apostle Paul was writing and telling Timothy what a preacher, what the bishop ought to be. 1 Timothy 3 and verse 4. He said, one that ruleth well his own house, having his children in subjection with all gravity. For if a man know not how to rule his own house,
amen,
how shall he take care of the church of God?
Okay.
You know, it's a sad thing, but a lot of people that preach to a congregation, their home, their life at home is out of order.
Amen.
Children don't follow God. Our ministry starts at home.
Mm.
At the end of the day, we can't control the actions of another person. We can't make people follow Jesus. We can't make them do what we want to do. But what the Lord wants us to do is it's just like this. First, your relationship is with Him.
Amen.
Then your ministry begins with your family. And then it begins at the local church. What a tragedy would it be if we preached and saw thousands of people saved, but then our own family, the loved ones in our own household, they perish, brother.
Wow.
You know, I've prayed to the Lord like that, and I got two little boys. One's 5, one's 2. Now I have a wife at home, and I said, Lord, it don't matter where I go, how many people I preach to, how many souls that you may win through my preaching or whatever, but Lord, if those two little boys don't make it, then I failed.
Yes.
If they're not in heaven, if we don't walk through those pearly gates together, then it's all for nothing. The Lord wants our ministry to start at home. I'm telling you this, to start with your family.
Yes.
The people that are around you. God puts you in their life for a reason. I know Brother Matt's testimony, his sister preached the gospel to him. What if she had not? What if she'd have concentrated on what's going on at church or the people on her job and neglected her own family? The Bible says that if you neglect your family, you're worse than an infidel. Mm. Someone who has no faith. Your ministry starts at home with the people that are around you. But what I wanted to say about being ready is 1 Timothy 3 and verse 6. It says, not a novice, lest being lifted up with pride, he falls into the condemnation of the devil. This is something that I've sought the Lord with very much, being a young minister. The word novice, it means to sprung up. Mm. Popped up overnight. It means a newly planted plant. Newly planted. It's just sprung up. It's tender. And you notice when a lot of times young people in the Lord, people that are just saved, every one of them is called to preach.
Come on.
But the problem with that is that plant needs to grow. It needs to be nurtured and it needs to be strengthened, because vines come to choke it out. Thorns and thistles rise up to choke the Word of God out. And the Bible says that novice can be lifted up with pride and fall into the condemnation of the devil. Lifted up, it means just like a puff of smoke. Mm. It just comes up, but you know what that puff of smoke does? It's quickly gone.
Yes.
That's what pride will do for you. It'll give you a temporary pleasure and it'll make you feel all warm and good inside, but it's quickly gone. And the Lord says that you can fall there into the condemnation of the devil. It means the judgment of the devil. What happened to the devil? He's lifted up in pride. He's going to be like the Most High, but it was just like a puff of smoke. He was there for a moment, now he's gone. And he's been brought so low that he cannot be reconciled unto God. That's what pride can do for us, separate us from the Lord.
That's right.
And that's why the Lord says, not a novice. I'm talking about humility. Mm-hmm. Are you ready? I pray like this, Lord, to keep me on my knees.
Yeah.
And keep me dependent upon you. Keep me trusting you. I'll be at work sometimes and I'll just say, Lord, I don't need this job. And I really don't need this money. The bank may say I need this money, but I really don't need it. Lord, I just need you. I need you working in my life. I need the Holy Spirit flowing through my life. I got it right here, brother. I appreciate it. I forgot this last night. Lord, I need you, because I'm a very bad man when I get separated from you.
Oh, that was true.
And if I get prideful and lifted up, like that song says, I thought of myself as a mighty big man. Yeah. What I came to realize is I can't even walk in a way that pleases God without Him holding my hand.
Yeah.
Are you ready? Are you ready? And another thing, we need humility. And we need to learn how to receive the grace of God. Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 10, the Apostle Paul said that the grace that God bestowed upon him was not in vain, but he labored more abundantly than them all.
Yes.
Yet not I, he says, it wasn't him doing it, but the grace of God that was with me. If we're going to serve the Lord, we need grace. Grace is power to serve the Lord.
Yes.
Grace is power to stay in the race. A lot of people get burned out. I think the average time for a youth pastor is like 3 or 4 years, and then they quit forever. Because they get burnt out in the flesh. That's what the flesh does. It's just like a firework, man. It's a loud pop, a lot of pretty colors. But in a few moments, you can't find it. It's gone. But grace, Paul said that God bestowed grace upon my life. And by the grace of God, I labored more abundantly than them all. And it wasn't him doing it, but the grace of God that was with him. Grace allows us to labor for the Lord. Grace won't run out. I am debtor. I am ready. And then in verse 16 of Romans chapter 1, he says, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. For it's the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. I'm not ashamed of it. Not that if you press me, I'll tell you that I go to church sometimes.
Come on.
But it means that if you give me an ear to hear, just a little crack in the door, I'm going to preach Christ and Him crucified unto you. I'm not ashamed of it.
Hallelujah.
It's not a fairy tale, but it is the power of God that results in salvation. You know, the cross, to a lot of them, they thought it was a shameful thing, a humiliating and a shameful death. They ripped His clothes off. They mocked Him. They ridiculed Him. If He's truly the Son of God, why don't He come down and save Himself? He saved others. Why don't He save Himself? And to the carnal, natural eye, they couldn't see what was really taking place there that day. The Romans weren't allowed to be crucified. If a Roman had to be put to death, they'd just chop his head off and get it over real quick. But it's a shameful thing to nail a man completely naked to a cross in a spot where everyone could see it. But the Apostle Paul said, I'm not ashamed of it. What you don't understand, what you see is a naked man on a cross. I'm proud to be the sinless Son of God who shed His blood for the sin of the world. And the moment that I believed upon Him, I found the power of God that results in salvation. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 1:23, he said, we preach Christ crucified. To the Jews, it's a stumbling block. To the Greeks, it's foolishness. But unto us who are called, Christ is the wisdom of God and the power of God. We're not ashamed of it. Hallelujah. Don't be ashamed of Jesus. He says that it's the power of God. The word power is dunamis power. I really like the word. It's where we get the word dynamite from. Power. Hallelujah. That's what the cross of Christ is. That's what the gospel is. It's the power of God. The saving power of God. The miracle working power of God. I like this definition. It's the power of the resurrected Christ.
Yes.
Living and dwelling in the Christian church.
Hallelujah.
That's what the gospel is. That's why we spent a lot of years in other churches where we really never learned anything.
Come on.
Our life was never changed. We might have learned some scripture. I thank God that I'm through with that.
That's right.
Just learning a bunch of words.
Amen.
Doing religious things that can't be applied to our life, that can never help us in a real and a practical way. I'll never give another dollar to anything that promotes such as that.
Amen.
But we found the power of
God.
Yes. We found a resurrected Christ. We preach Christ crucified, but Christ is not on a cross anymore. He's a crucified, resurrected, glorified Christ. And today He sits at the right hand of the Father. The Bible says He's been given a name that's above every name, and there's coming swiftly a day that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord.
Hallelujah.
But where the gospel is preached, it's the dunamis, there's dynamite.
Yes.
Things can happen The power of God is there. The power that's able to convict you of sin. The power of God that's able to save a lost soul. The power of God that's able to fill you with the baptism of the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in other tongues. The power of God that's able to heal a sick body. The power of God that's able to bring a marriage back together. None of that is possible where God is not, but where the gospel of Jesus Christ is preached there, the power of God is.
Amen.
And there the Holy Spirit is there and He's willing and able. It's the power
Amen.
Of God that results in
Amen.
Salvation
Hallelujah.
To everyone that believes.
Yes.
That's God's way that you believe.
Amen.
I really struggled with that. I was telling the men at the supper table last night when I first began to learn the message of the cross. I said, how do you put faith in the cross?
Yeah.
What does that even mean?
Right.
Then God gave me a revelation. Just simple as this. It's not about you.
Mm-hmm.
But it's about what Jesus did for you.
Amen.
He did it in your place.
Yeah.
And all God wants you to do is trust.
Yeah.
To rely. To commit your spiritual well-being unto the Lord Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
That's what it means to have faith in the Christ. It means to abandon all self-effort and believe upon Him. And God says when you do that, it results in salvation. It results in a change.
Amen.
There when people believe the gospel Amen. Of Jesus Christ, it's the power of God unto salvation to the Jew first
Amen.
And also to the Greek. It means it's for everybody.
Amen.
It's for
That's
everybody.
Good.
You know, the lie of the devil is, you know, Christianity's for white people. Islam is for black people. That's a lie.
That's right.
Yeah.
Jesus shed His blood for all.
Yeah.
Amen.
No matter what color.
Amen.
No matter what the culture is. I'm so sick of that. Culture talk in the church. When you receive Jesus,
right.
you get a new culture.
Yes.
The past has been washed away. I wouldn't even begin to tell you what my culture is, but I'm telling you, when I met Jesus, that died.
Yes.
And I got a new culture because I became a new creature.
Yes.
A new vessel in which God can live. That is what the gospel is. It is the power of God that results in a change. When God touches something, it changes.
Amen.
I believe that one thing that's in many churches is just spiritualism.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we come and sing and we get excited and we shed tears and, you know, sometimes they come down at the front and fall over and all this stuff and it's just a feeling.
Yeah.
And I thank God that where He is, there is a feeling.
Amen.
You can feel it. But salvation's not a feeling.
Come on.
Amen.
Salvation is a miracle at working experience, a spiritual experience that occurs within your heart and life, and it results in a change. Brother Matt said it last night. Grace is the divine influence on your heart and its reflection in your life. Grace is something that begins to work on the inside, but before long you can see it magnified on the outside. A great change. Jesus moving on the inside, working on the outside. That is the power of God.
Yes.
That's what we must have. Otherwise, we might as well stay at the house.
That's right.
But if we can be in a place where the power of God is, where the gospel, thank God for people that are not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ and where it is proclaimed. Faith is available. Faith can be established where that gospel is preached. And it results in salvation. The word salvation, it's not limited to a born-again experience, but it means deliverance, it means preservation, it means safety, and it means salvation. It means that everything that you need is in the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.
It is the power of God.
Thank you, Jesus.
It results in salvation. It results in deliverance. If you struggle with some kind of sin, you don't need to go out and buy somebody's book. You need to come back to the book.
Yes.
And the gospel.
Amen.
It results in deliverance.
Amen.
If you need power to stay, power to run the race. Lord, I don't want to be like a little child that's blown to and fro by every wind of doctrine. I want
Amen.
To stay put. Lord. I want to stay on the solid ground, the solid foundation that you've put me on. The gospel is that.
Yeah.
The gospel results in preservation. It results in safety. We don't need to fear our enemies. We don't need to fear any of the wiles of the devil, because in Christ we have the whole armor of God.
Amen.
We have preservation and we have safety.
That's good.
And something so great, we shouldn't be ashamed of it. You know, the Bible tells us not to be conformed to the image of the world, but to be transformed by the renewing of our mind. I think there's a lot of Christians who put a coat on when they go out into the world to cover up what's within.
Yeah.
And we can muddy up the name of Jesus by a worldly lifestyle, trying to fit in with everyone else. But Jesus said, you don't light that candle and hide it under a bushel, but you let it shine. Let it give light. The Christ within you, the light of the world. Jesus said that in John chapter 1 and verse 4, it says, in him was life, and this life was the light of men.
Yes.
He is the light. But then he comes back and says, you are the light of the world. It means Christ within you is the light that has been deposited. And those out in darkness, they need a light.
Yes.
A guiding light. A lot of people are, as I said, they're ignorant. They just don't know. But the Lord can use you. You don't have to be an apostle, an evangelist, a pastor, or a teacher. You can just be a Christian.
Yes.
A debtor.
Thank you, Jesus.
That owes to our fellow man to tell him what it is that we've been so blessed to.